Artificial intelligence is a technique by which computers perform all kinds of tasks. You could say cognitive tasks that in the earlier days only could be done by humans. Working on data, making sense of data, up to the point that they could even help us make decisions and choices. Within the field of AI, there are several approaches, you could say. So one approach focuses more on data and data-based AI. So then you write algorithms to work with data and that you can also train to interpret data. And the other approach focuses more on knowledge, on how we understand the data. So you need context and also categories to place your data in. It's two different approaches that both work. The knowledge-based form of AI works more towards expert systems. And the data-based form of AI is very good at pattern recognition, image recognition, speech recognition, etc.
It's very difficult for AI researchers to define what AI is. But my idea is that AI means we can create new world of intelligent activities together with humans and machines.
AI somehow blurs the boundaries between humans and technologies. If technologies become intelligent, whatever you may mean by that word intelligence, then they start to be able to do things that only humans could do. It also raises the question to what extent humans are so unique. Are we unique if computers can do our work? I think that AI systems will also change our world, change how we interact, how we understand ourselves, our bodies, how we do healthcare, how we do education. And those implications of AI systems need to be addressed at an early stage of development. Now that we see that it's moving so fast, now we start to understand that AI is changing the world. And that enables us to address ethical questions during the design and the innovation itself, rather than only afterwards. People are often afraid that algorithms or AI will result in job loss. And I think that's definitely the case. Jobs will get lost because of AI. But the current situation is that actually also a lot of new jobs reappear, but they're totally different kind of jobs. They are typically in education. And that's, I think, a big change. So people in production companies, factories, spend now sometimes up to a quarter of their time to education, to being taught how to work with new technologies. The struggle we are facing is not a struggle between the people whose work might be taken over and might not be taken over by the robots. I think the new social line will be between the people who have the flexibility and the resilience to find out who they are and what they want to be every time and time again with new technologies, and the people who don't have the flexibility and resilience. AI to support humanity, that's what we should aim for. And that means that the human values that we find so important should be central in the development of AI systems.
Les voitures sans chauffeur, c'est quelque chose qui a l'air d'être extrêmement prosaïque. En fait, ça ne l'est pas du tout. Comment est-ce qu'on fait pour décider ce qu'il faudrait faire d'un point de vue éthique si on se trouve dans une situation où on risque d'écraser quelqu'un et où, si on essaye de contourner cette personne, on risque d'en mettre en danger une autre. Imaginez que vous soyez en train de faire votre jogging et puis vous voyez un trolley qui fonce à toute allure, les freins ont lâché, il fonce sur 5 personnes. Vous avez la possibilité, en tirant le levier, de le faire passer sur une voie secondaire où se trouve une personne. Qu'est-ce qu'il faut faire? La plupart des gens disent qu'il faut tirer le levier. D'une part, on donne l'impression qu'il y a une bonne réponse et donc qu'il faudrait agir de telle manière sans explorer d'autres voies. Et deuxièmement, on risque de donner l'impression que toute l'éthique peut se limiter à ces soi-disant bonnes réponses et puis aussi à une alternative entre deux possibilités. Être moral, réfléchir moralement ou se comporter moralement, c'est pas juste appliquer à un programme, c'est aussi être motivé à agir moralement.
The problem in educating AI is that you need ethical frameworks from which you educate them. You teach the algorithms, in a sense, to be ethical somehow. And that's, of course, kind of a delicate question, because fortunately, we do not have this one single ethical framework for everybody that everybody should follow. That would be a totalitarian world where there's only one way to live your life. If there's one thing that we believe in, and that we believe in here at UNESCO, it's that there is a world of plurality, of many different views, and we want to live together in that plurality.
For me, what I would like to put on the table, what I think is absolutely crucial in our development AI of AI technologies, is that we put our human vulnerability center stage. We develop these technologies with an understanding and while taking into account our human vulnerabilities. And I think that will help to create AI technologies that make us feel more safe in our interaction with these technologies and really adapt to us rather than we as people adapting to the technologies. Our vulnerability is what's often defined as our capability to be heard. So it's what unites us really as people. We all can get hurt in a physical sense, but also in a social sense when we, in our relations with other people, we can get hurt. And it's about our emotions, pleasant emotions, but also unpleasant emotions like fear and shame and yeah, all of these more difficult things. I think if we shape AI technology with an understanding of our human vulnerability and in particular our social vulnerability, so how we relate to other people, I think we can create it in a way that at least does not negatively affect our relations, but maybe even enhances them in some way. What you see currently is that technologies like social media, they exploit human vulnerabilities. So they try to keep us longer on these platforms because we might get a new like, so we keep coming back. So it exploits this vulnerability of wanting to get these likes. And instead, what I want to work towards is technologies that help us engage and think about our vulnerability so that we shape our action, our co-action together with these technologies much more actively and consciously.
Another ethical issue regarding AI typically has to do with bias. I think that's what people are really worried about, rightly so. So AI is basically a system that interprets the world. It makes sense of the world, recognizes pictures of cancer tissue, or it recognizes faces of people, etc. And of course, if you make a judgment, then you do that from a framework, and there can be a bias in the framework. So I think with older school technologies, maybe you know the typical examples. There's this viral movie on the internet of a soap dispenser, where only if you place a white hand below it, it gives you soap. If your skin is not white, it doesn't work. So there's a bias in the system. It somehow only works for white privileged people. You don't want that to happen in a world of AI, especially if decisions are made by AI systems kind of autonomously, or at least if they have a lot of influence on how people in banks or in hospitals or in politics make choices.
There is really indeed a genuine risk that a minority populations, because we don't have so much data about some parts of our world, of our society, that they don't get reflected into these technologies. There, I think as engineers, we really have to be conscious to consciously think about including minority and more vulnerable populations, if you will, in our technologies, so that it also reflects these aspects. And I think one of the main things that we can do there is to make sure we have diverse teams, diverse engineering teams. If you're not part of those vulnerable or minority populations, it's very difficult to see these biases because they don't affect you. Gender equality and AI technology, I think on the one hand, AI technology can help us alleviate some of our biases because it brings our biases to the foreground. So for example, if you Google the word professor, what you get is the first 30 pictures are almost all white men. Because in our society, apparently, that's what most professors are, white men. So it's like the technology provides a mirror to us of what's happening in our society.
Le genre, c'est un problème pour l'intelligence artificielle. Par exemple, on sait que les intelligences artificielles vont faire du marketing ciblé en fonction du genre. Les annonces d'emploi pour des emplois dans les champs scientifiques ou technologiques vont être moins ciblées vont moins cibler les femmes et donc elles vont voir apparaître sur leur écran moins d'annonces dans ces champs-là. Donc vous voyez là, il y a vraiment un serpent qui se mord la queue. Puisque ce sont des hommes qui conçoivent l'intelligence artificielle en majorité aujourd'hui et qui les conçoivent à destination des hommes qui vont continuer à développer cette intelligence artificielle. Il y a donc vraiment aujourd'hui une importance à ouvrir le champ de l'intelligence artificielle aux femmes, mais aussi à ouvrir la manière dont on code l'intelligence artificielle pour qu'elle soit plus réaliste.
Famous examples of voice assistants that are very subservient and always try to help make themselves small and humble, whereas a male voice typically is much more powerful, etc. That are really deeply rooted gender stereotypes that you could have.
AI should not be the machine to change the world uniformly. AI can work to reinforce the local cultures, so we can respect the variety of the cultures. In Japan, we have concept of wabi-sabi. We respect some silence of the nature, and AI can support to verbalize the concept. For example, it is difficult to explain the Japanese culture to foreign people, but AI can support to translate the concept by giving concrete examples. Of course, human beings can do that, but AI have much data, so AI technology can work to enhance the explanation world. Or, moreover, we can develop a new local concept, getting possible ideas from the machines. For example, machines can propose, maybe you think this is important, which I didn't notice yet. We have carried out an example of usage of artificial intelligence technology to enhance creative activities of local people. All ladies and all gentlemen gathered in a local community center, and they created poems expressing their old memories of the local town. The machine helped them to verbalize their old memories. The machine gave possible vocabularies to explain their old memories.
One of the most important ethical issues in relation to AI that we're facing now is to better understand where lies responsibility. So when AI starts to recommend decisions or even take decisions on our behalf, I think in the end, we are always responsible, but then who is the we? I mean, is it the owner is it the user of the software? Is it the people who created the software? So we're creating these new kinds of interactions. And I think what we need to do is to investigate how to shape these technologies, AI technologies, such that they allow us to be able to take that responsibility. If the technology is very intransparent, it's like this black box that we don't know what's going on, we cannot interact with it, I mean, then I cannot take, if I'm the user of the technology, how can I take responsibility for something that does something that I cannot even influence or understand? Investigating, I mean, explainable AI is of course mentioned often, but I think it's not only about explaining the black box, but also influencing the black box. So directability, I think, is really crucial. As engineers, first of all, we should take our responsibility. We have a habit sometimes of saying, hey, I'm just the engineer, I just created technology, it's not my responsibility what then happens in society. So I think changing this narrative is, I think, absolutely crucial. As an engineer, you are responsible for the technology that we create.
We need to have societal discussions in the media, on TV, in newspapers, on the internet, in discussion fora, addressing how AI might change our daily lives and how we might be somehow, you could say, critical in dealing with that. If we don't ask ethical questions from science or from UNESCO or from ethics and philosophy, then it's only the companies that ask the questions. The companies that design the systems to make money with them, basically. Of course, there are a lot of good companies who also really want to make the world a better place, but that's not self-evident. Of course, there's always also that big economic interest.
We have to create regulations, so law that helps shape the context in which we can develop these technologies, because it doesn't always make business sense to do the right thing. So we need some kind of framework to help guide the development of these technologies.
Qu'est-ce qui se passerait si la communauté internationale ne saisissait pas de la question de l'intelligence artificielle? Ce qui se passe aujourd'hui, quelques cultures qui sont en train de développer leur intelligence artificielle, qui détiennent une forme de monopole et qui insufflent une certaine vision issue de leur propre culture au sein de l'intelligence artificielle. Or après, on risque de penser que puisque c'est dans la machine, puisque c'est dans la boîte, c'est forcément vrai. Or, il y a différentes manières de penser les questions et il est aussi important que l'intelligence artificielle puisse prendre en compte la diversité humaine, la diversité qui va se jouer au niveau physique, au niveau des systèmes de référence culturelle, au niveau des manières de réfléchir telle ou telle chose.
The key of the story of Frankenstein was that Frankenstein failed to take responsibility for his monster. He was so afraid of it that he walked away. The monster went into the world, didn't know how to behave, felt not really somehow recognized, wanted a wife which he didn't get, etc. And then he became a monster. So the lesson we can learn from the Frankenstein story is that you should not leave your technologies to their own devices. You should take responsibility not only for making a technology, but also for introducing it in society. You should educate it, you should teach it. For AI, this is exactly the same situation. So what we are doing with AI is that we develop technologies that do things that are beyond our field of influence. So we cannot tell them what to do. They learn, they develop patterns of interaction that cannot be reduced to what we put into them. So the only way to deal with these systems is to educate them and to hold themselves accountable for what they do. But then they need help. If we do not do that, then we end up in the same situation as Victor Frankenstein, leaving them to themselves, first thinking, wow, we made a beautiful thing, and then becoming afraid that they might take over the world, but then it's too late. We should do it now. We should learn to educate the algorithms before they take over. And I see that in a lot of discussions, we still separate ethics and humans from technologies and the labs where we make the technologies. It's about the human subjects and the technical objects. And I believe that they're totally intertwined, that we are technological beings and we need to take responsibility for that. So that's what I feel as a mission, maybe almost, to make sure that we don't miss all the opportunities that we have to connect ethics and technology in a world where they are really very often kept far away and far apart.